Hey, Seraphin here, and in life, good things tend to be replicated. Case in point, flight. You can see it in birds, bats, and insects, despite the fact that none of these groups of animals are closely related. They all fly and soar beautifully in remarkably similar ways. It's called convergent evolution, and it actually makes a lot of sense because something that good that helps you survive longer is very likely to be preserved and selected for. As humans, we are no different. Well, we can't fly, obviously, but separate cultures around the world do frequently come up with similar ideas of doing something. Sure, it's partly because people intermingle and cultures spread, but if you really think about it, there are only so many ways to do things, and if you roll the dice hundreds of times, you're bound to get some of the same outcomes. Regardless of how these ideas arise, it's the effective ones, the ones that work, that are more likely to be remembered for a long time and passed down to future generations. As it turns out, sourdough is one of these things. You may associate sourdough with sourdough artisan bread, a hard, rustic loaf filled with flavor and a crisp crust. You might imagine a bakery filled with the smells of baked bread, but that's not the only version of sourdough bread out there, especially when we're talking about how sourdough is used in the Far East. Steamed breads, or manto, made with sourdough stands out as a uniquely different sourdough bread when compared to the Western sourdough bread that we are familiar with. It has a smooth, glossy finish, white color inside and out, a soft, moist, and uniform, fluffy cum texture in contrast to the dark brown finish of Western sourdough artisan bread that sports a crispy crust and an airy, open crumb with a chewy texture. The history of steam bread consumption can be traced all the way back to the Warring States period more than two millennia ago. This fact is supported by the written history of ancient China, and as for sourdough bread, their long history of consumption in China is supported by interesting archaeological findings in Subeixi of Xinjiang, China, as mentioned in this paper. The researchers in this paper stated that they were able to reconstruct the recipe of a 2,500-year-old bread, and their analysis led them to discover that ancient Chinese people made the bread using a renewable starter created from barley and broom corn. This paper provided direct evidence that people in ancient China made sourdough bread as early as 500 BCE, if not earlier. Now, while it's interesting to see that sourdough has been used in China for millennia, as the oldest and most original form of leavened bread, sourdough bread hails all the way back to ancient Egypt, to the second millennium BC, where bread was a staple consumed by both the rich and poor alike. It's even said that pyramid builders were given a daily allowance of beer, onions, and bread. It's likely that they discovered this way of leavening by accident, when they baked their bread by incorporating leftover dough or something similar. I can imagine the absolute wonder of realizing that the bread they baked in such a way was fluffier and more flavorful due to the fermentation process. Eventually, it's probable that they realized that keeping a small portion of dough for the next batch of bread would allow them to make these loaves over and over again, which is probably how sourdough starters came to be. Old dough made of sourdough, or lao jiaozi, such as this, have been a part of how steamed bread was made in the Far East for more than two millennia before the introduction of commercial yeast. From ancient Egypt, it's thought that sourdough spread throughout Europe, making its way into ancient Greece and continuing through the Roman Empire. Roughly speaking, we can say that this is the pathway that led to the sourdough bread in many Western bakeries. When you bite into the crisp crust of a sourdough baguette, this is part of the history of what you're savoring. Now, talking about biting into a crispy sourdough baguette, the importance of the crumb firmness and the crust brittleness in improving the flavor of the bread has long been established by researchers. There aren't a lot of ingredients in a baguette, so it derives its complex aroma and flavor from volatile organic compounds released through the long fermentation that the dough undergoes before baking. When we bake the dough into a crusty baguette and take a bite of it, the firm crumb and crispy crust trigger a release of volatile organic compounds into our mouths, making the bread taste and smell even better. This is why getting a crisp crust is a must when making a good baguette, and this seems to be a prerequisite for the many Western breads that we've come to know. But that is not the case in many parts of the world. Although bread consumption is on the rise in the Far East, most consumers still prefer soft and fluffy breads, such as that of Tangzhong or Yudane breads. It has long been speculated that perhaps perhaps this may be due to the fact that bread is not a staple food in these countries. Steamed rice is. And steamed rice is anything but rustic and crispy. So as more and more people are trying out this new dietary staple, when it comes to texture and taste, they're still rooting for something closely related to the existing staple food that they regularly consume. Hence the softer bread. On top of that, some consumers in the Far East have concerns about the acrylamide content in the dark crust of crispy breads. Acrylamide is a chemical that naturally forms in breads during high-temperature baking. It's actually formed during the Maillard reaction, which is why the darker the bread is, the more acrylamide it probably has. Acrylamide is also one of the reasons that drives more consumers to steamed bread, because steaming foods does not create acrylamide. But here's the thing, it has been long established that free asparagine is an important precursor for acrylamide in cereal. And in a previous study in 2004, it was found that in general, most of the asparagine was utilized after 2 hours of fermentation with yeast. Sourdough fermentation, on the other hand, did not reduce the content of free asparagine as efficiently, but had a strong negative impact on asparagine utilization by yeast. Now, this is quite alarming for sourdough lovers, but more recent research reveals a much more nuanced aspect to this area of our growing understanding of the issue. As indicated in this research paper, which stated that besides the fact that sourdoughs produced by using combinations of selected lab strains improve the quality parameters of bread, fermentation with prepared sourdoughs also reduced the acrylamide content in wheat bread samples by 29.5% to 67.2%. Thus, the selected lab combinations can be recommended for improving the quality of bread, including the reduction of acrylamide. Here is another thing we need to point out. The ratio of lactic acid bacteria to wild yeast in most mature sourdough starters is 100 to 1. Although the number of yeast appears to be small in comparison, wild yeast is also an important factor in sourdough fermentation. As yeast have been shown to reduce the content of free asparagine, we can reasonably speculate that the wild yeast in sourdough could do something similar. Furthermore, in many sourdough recipes, a bit of instant yeast is usually added to speed up fermentation, so that has to be taken into account too. On the baking side, some bakers posit that sourdough makes the bread paler by inhibiting the Maillard reaction due to an acidic pH. If this were true, then sourdough bread should have lower levels of acrylamide, but the research on this is a little more complex than that. In one study, researchers chemically acidified a dough with lactic acid and found that there was no reduction in the acrylamide content of the bread. Quoting from the paper, "Our results are in agreement with the publications by other authors who chemically acidified dough but did not observe a reduction of acrylamide content in bread." The paper noted, though, that selected strains of sourdough lactic acid bacteria were very capable of reducing acrylamide content, so it's more likely that those who observed paler crusts in their sourdough breads were seeing the hard work of their sourdough microorganisms rather than just a simple chemical reaction. We really should appreciate our sourdough starters more. Okay, so far we have covered a bit of sourdough history from Far East to the West, a bit of science on acrylamide for sure. In the Far East, pretty much like what's going on in the West, there's a rising consumer demand for reduced use of additives, and this goes with interest in clean label ingredients that are recognized and accepted by consumers. The addition of sourdough meets these requirements because, as we have learned, sourdough influences all aspects of bread quality in a mostly positive way. One study comparing yeast and sourdough steamed breads found several differences in the aroma active compounds of the two. The main differences were attributed to one compound with a wheat-like smell and another with a mushroom aroma. So, in case you've ever thought that your sourdough bread smelled a bit like mushrooms, you may have a point. Alongside those two aroma compounds, the researchers also found differences in compounds with floral and almond scents. Obviously, there's a lot that goes into the delicious scents of sourdough. In Europe, traditionally, various rye breads from Germany, Central European countries, and Scandinavia are based on sourdough. Rye is the second most common cereal used for bread production after wheat. Due to their high non-starch polysaccharide and lysine content, rye breads are gaining attention from the wider public. From a nutritional point of view, non-starch polysaccharides are dietary fiber, which have been associated with numerous positive health benefits. And lysine is an essential amino acid that is a precursor to many proteins. It is necessary for human health, but our bodies cannot make it, so we have to get it from our food. The issue with rye bread is that it has a denser texture, smaller volume, and more pronounced earthy, sour flavor when compared to wheat bread. The quality of a rye bread is highly influenced by the properties of its starch and its alpha amylase activity. Rye starch gelatinizes at a relatively low temperature, 55 to 70 degrees Celsius, which coincides with the temperature range for maximum alpha amylase activity, around 60 to 70 degrees Celsius. Rye flour with high alpha amylase activity yields soft, sticky dough, which may be too fluid to be processed into bread due to extensive starch degradation. Alpha amylase has an optimal pH at 5.5 and becomes inactive at pH lower than 4.0. The pH of sourdough changes according to the stage of fermentation. Typically, it ranges from pH 3.5 to 5, so that explains why various rye breads are based on sourdough. Another way to mitigate high alpha amylase activity is subjecting the starch in rye flour to a heat treatment. Traditionally, it's called scalding flour in the West. This process inactivates some of the enzymes and hence lowers the alpha amylase activity. There are many variations on how to scald rye flour. But in general, from this paper, we know that 10 to 30% of flour is usually used for scalding, with a flour to boiling water ratio of 1 to 2 to 1 to 3. Following that, the cool-down process could take anywhere from 4 to 12 hours. The final temperatures of the scalds range from 25 to 30 degrees Celsius, and all scalds usually end up with a degree of gelatinization going from 85% to 100%. Now, let's compare scalding flour to the Tangzhong or Yudane that we're quite familiar with. One of the main objectives of scalding flour is to mitigate the impact of high alpha amylase activity. Combining this with the fact that rye proteins do not form a coherent structure during dough mixing, there isn't much to be considered about the impact of scalding on the gluten strength. Baking quality of rye flour is mainly controlled by starch, arabinoxylins, and amylase enzymes, with proteins playing a non-structural role. So even if a large amount of gluten proteins in the rye flour were inactivated during scalding, it wouldn't be much of an issue. Technically, from this paper, and I quote, baking quality of rye flour is mainly controlled by a so-called carbohydrate amylolytic complex, and to the lesser extent, proteins and proteolytic activity. On the other hand, when using the Tangzhong or Yudane method of bread making, we don't really need to have too many concerns about high alpha amylase activity. The Tangzhong method pays more attention to gluten denaturing and starch gelatinization that bring about increased moisture and saccharide content, especially disaccharides, maltose. To further understand the difference between the two, the scalding process of whole grain rye flour increased maltose concentrations by 6.14 times in comparison with non-scalded flour. Yudane, as indicated in this paper, increased maltose concentration by about 2 times. Of course, we're talking about bread flour here, so it's definitely not an apples-to-apples comparison. Still, there is an effort to increase the effectiveness of Tangzhong or Yudane in this aspect. From this thesis, we can learn that it is highly recommended to use the Tangzhong only after it has gone through aging for 24 hours in the fridge at 7 degrees Celsius. With rising saccharides due to the scalding process, there is a concern about the level of acrylamide. But from the paper, we are assured by knowing that breads with 5 and 10% of scalded whole grain rye flour has a similar level of acrylamide to the control. So we might speculate that the incorporation of Tangzhong or Yudane in bread making with bread flour, being of a lower maltose concentration, would most likely have a similar result. That being said, one paper on rye grains found that less acrylamide was produced per unit of asparagine in rye flour when compared to wheat flour. This may be due to the high proline levels in rye flour. Proline is an amino acid that not only interferes with acrylamide formation, but also reacts with acrylamide to reduce its levels. So this could be part of the reason why using rye flour might actually result in less acrylamide levels in the resulting bread. Moving on from acrylamide, let's talk about something sweeter. Maltose, a simple sugar, plays a significant role in producing a good quality bread. It contributes to the natural sweetness we get from Tangzhong or Yudane breads. It is also associated with the crust color of the bread. During fermentation, maltose is a substrate consumed by yeast to produce carbon dioxide and other aromatic substances. Maltose can be imported by Fructolactobacillus sanfrancescensis, which then releases glucose into the medium after cleaving the maltose with an enzyme, maltose phosphorylase. This ability to consume maltose actually plays a role in the bacteria's microbial relationships. You see, Fructolactobacillus sanfrancescensis is often found in association with a yeast called Kazakhstania humilis in a traditional sourdough. Part of this is because this yeast is generally maltose negative. It can't break down maltose, while Fructolactobacillus sanfrancescensis is maltose positive, as we just mentioned. So it makes a lot of sense that these two would get together and develop a mutualistic relationship. This is an important fact to observe. Now, the fun question to ask is, what if we feed our sourdough starter with tangzhong that is supercharged with maltose? Well, that'll be for our next project. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and bye!